Bismillah wa alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa man tamasaka bi sunnatihi bi ihsanin ila yawmiddin amma ba'd. After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending the salutations upon the Messenger alayhi salatu wa salam and upon his family and upon his companions and upon all those who follow upon his guidance and to the establishment of the last day, to proceed, ikhwan, فَنَوَاسِلُ مَعَكُمْ فِي هَذِهِ اللَّيْلَةِ الْمُبَارَكَةِ الْكَرِيمَةِ عَوْنًا مِنَ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ ذَاكِرًا نَفْسِي وَأَيَّاكُمْ. So we continue with our brothers and our sisters in this blessed and noble night of ours, seeking the aid and the assistance of our Lord, the most merciful and the most compassionate. ذَاكِرًا نَفْسِي وَأَيَّاكُمْ. Reminding ourselves firstly, and our brothers and our sisters secondly. مُتَوَسِّلِينَ يَا إِخْوَانَ سَامِعِينَ إِلَى كَلَامِ الْعَلَّامَةِ الْإِمَامِ الشَّيْخِ أَبِي عَبْدِ الرَّحْمَنِ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ بِنِ عُمَرِ الْعَدَنِي حَفِظَهَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. Continuing with our mothers and our brothers and our daughters, listening to the words of the noble Alama, the noble and eminent Shaykh, who's known to us as Abu Abdul Rahman Abdullah ibn Umar al-Adani, حَفِظَهَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَلَى تَعْلِيقِهِ عَلَى الْكِتَابِ عَقِيدَتِي الْإِمَامَيْنِ الجليلين أبي زرعة وأبي حاتم الرازيين رحمهم الله تعالى. As he is continuing with us in his commentary of the Aqeedah of the two noble Imams of Al-Razi. Translator's note: the first Imam is Abu Zura'a Ubaidullah ibn Abdul Karim Al-Razi. And as for the second Imam, he's known to us as Abu Hatim Muhammad ibn Idris al-Razi rahimahumallahu ta'ala.
Alhamdulillah, as-salatu
wa-salam kathira.
So we can continue with the last speech of the Imam. حفظه الله وسلمه الله من كل سوء ومكروه.
قل بائن من خلقه لم يكتفي بأن يشهد بأن عبيد الرازي رحمه الله, ولهذا أكد ذلك هشام بن عبيد الرازي رحمه الله فقال له قل باء, وهو كذلك ماذا؟ وهو في كل مكان, وهو في كل مكان. ولهذا أكد ذلك هشام بن عبيد الرازي رحمه الله.
So now the last point that we mentioned, as he's talking about the statement of the two Imams, as they have mentioned continuing in their book, وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى عَلَى عَرْشِهِ بَائِنٌ مِّنْ خَلْقِهِ. He says, as the next point, that Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we believe that Allah is above His Arsh and He's not among the creation. كَمَا وَصَفَ نَفْسَهُ فِي كِتَابِهِ وَعَلَى لِسَانِ رَسُولِهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Just as He has mentioned about Himself in His book, and just as it was mentioned upon the tongue of His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bila kayfin, and we do this without saying how. And then he goes on to mention that the Jahmiyya, this group that is known as Al-Jahmiyya, translator's note, the followers of Jahm ibn Safwan, they have the opinion that Allah is everywhere, that Allah is everywhere, and this is incorrect. He says, so for this reason, it was affirmed by the Imam al-Razi that Allah Ta'ala is above His Arsh and He's not among the creation.
قال له قل بائن من خلقه لم يكتفي بأن يشهد بأن الله على عرشه حتى يشهد أنه بائن من خلقه.
He said in one instance there was a man and he was seized, he was captured and he was imprisoned until he repented. So he came to the Imams, Hisham al-Razi, and he said he repented to Allah Ta'ala. And then he said that, yes, Allah is above the Arsh. And he said, here the Imam, he said, do you say that he is not among the creation? So he says he affirmed that Allah Ta'ala, this man, he affirmed that Allah Ta'ala is above the Arsh.
فَلَمَّا قَالَ مَا أَدْرِي مَا بَائِن مِّنْ خَلْقِهِ قَالَ رُدُّوهِ إِلَى الْحَبْسِ.
So when the man who was in prison, Ikhwan, he said, after Hisham al-Razi asked him, do you say that Allah is above the Arsh? And he said, the man said, I do not, he said, do you say that Allah is above the Arsh and that he is not among his creation? He said, as for that, I don't know. So the Imam said, take him back to his prison, for indeed he has not yet repented to Allah Ta'ala.
فَإِنَّهُ لَمْ يَتُبْ.
For indeed he has not yet repented to Allah.
وهكذا كذلك روي عن الإمام مالك رحمه الله تعالى أنه قال الله في السماء وعلمه في كل مكان.
He said likewise it has been narrated upon the great Imam Malik ibn Anas رحمه الله تعالى, the great Imam of أهل السنة والجماعة from the lands of Al-Medina, that he used to say رحمه الله that Allah is above the heavens, but his knowledge has reached everywhere.
لا يخلو منه مكان.
And his knowledge, there's no place that the knowledge of Allah does not reach.
رواه ابن عبد البر عنه وروي من طرق كثيرة.
And this narration was collected by the great Imam Ibn Abd al-Barr, and it had many avenues or many chains of this narration.
ذكروا أهل تصانيف الاعتقاد عنه رحمه الله تعالى.
As the scholars who have composed books of the belief, they have collected and mentioned and transmitted this from Imam Malik رحمه الله تعالى.
فقوله الله في السماء وعلمه في كل مكان لا يخلو منه مكان هو بمعنى بائن من خلقه.
So when Imam Malik said رحمه الله that Allah is above the heavens and his knowledge reaches everywhere, and there's no place that his knowledge is free from, he says this has the meaning of the statement of these two imams, ba'inun min khalqi, that Allah is not among his creation.
وهو معنى قول الإمامين الجليلين كما وصف نفسه في كتابه وعلى لسان رسوله بلا كيف أحاط بكل شيء علما.
And he said this is the same meaning of the two great imams that we're studying their Aqidah today. Translator's note, once again he's talking about the Ikhwan, the two great imams, Abu Zura'a, you sisters write down this name, likewise you brothers, the first name is Abu Zura'a, Ubaydullah ibn Abdul Karim, Abu Zura'a, Ubaydullah ibn Abdul Karim al-Razi. Ubaydullah ibn Abdul Karim al-Razi. And as for the second Imam, his name is Abu Hatim Muhammad ibn Idris. Abu Hatim Muhammad ibn Idris. He says, and this has the same meaning of the statement of these two great imams, Abu Hatim and Abu Zura'a, as they say, just as Allah has mentioned about himself in his book, meaning the Quran, and just as it was on the tongue of his messenger Muhammad alayhi salatu salam, and we believe in this without saying how, and his knowledge reaches, encompasses all things.
فَعِلْمُهُ بِكُلِّ مَكَانٍ.
So the knowledge of Allah, now Allah is all knowledgeable of everything, every place. Allah's knowledge reaches everywhere.
وَأَمَّا هُوَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى فَفِي عُلُوِّهِ جَلَّ وَعَلَى.
But as for himself, Allah, the Mighty, the Majestic, then he has the characteristic of al-ulu. He is the Most High. He is above the creation.
فلا بد من هذا المعنى وهذا كذلك اللفظ.
So it's a must that the person understands this meaning and that he understands and he ascertains this phrase.
الذي يكون فيه التدقيق بين مذهب أهل السنة والجماعة ومذهب أهل التعطيل.
And this is the distinguishing factor between Ahlis, or one of the distinguishing factors between the people of the Sunnah and the people are from the madhab of Al-Ta'til. Those who say that Allah is everywhere. And Imam Al-Hakim, the great Imam Al-Hakim, he has collected in one of his tremendous books, The Science of Al-Hadith. With a chain of narration going all the way back to the great Imam Ibn Khuzaymah, rahimahullah ta'ala, translator's note, who died in the 3rd century. He died in the 300s. He said this chain goes back to the great Imam Muhammad Ibn Khuzaymah, that he said,
من لم يقر بأن الله تعالى فوق عرشه قد استوى فوق سبع سماوات فهو كافر.
He said, this great Imam, you sisters and you brothers, write this down. He said that Ibn Khuzaymah used to say that anyone who does not acknowledge, who does not believe, who does not attest that Allah is above the 7 heavens, then this one has disbelieved in Allah. Anyone who does not believe, does not attest, does not acknowledge that Allah is above his 7 heavens, then this one has disbelieved in Allah. He said, in this one, if he does not believe this, then it's upon him to repent to Allah. If he repents, bihamdillah. If he does not repent, then his neck is to be struck. Then he goes on to mention what was mentioned from the great Imam Ash-Shafi'i.
أي ابن خزيمة قال وإمامنا في الأصول والفروع أبو عبد الله محمد ابن إدريس الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى.
He said that Ibn Khuzaymah said, it has been narrated from our Imam Ash-Shafi'i that he is our Imam in Usul and likewise in the Furu'. And we lost our brothers on the conference call.
Welcome. This service is provided by free conference call. Please enter your PIN followed by the pound or hash. Thank you. Please announce yourself.
Ibn Khuzaymah قال وإمامنا في الأصول والفروع أبو عبد الله محمد ابن إدريس الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى ورضي عنه احتج في كتابه المبسوط.
He said that Ibn Khuzaymah said that our Imam in the أصول, in the fundamentals of the Deen, and in the فروع, those subcategories, he said Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i, he has mentioned as a proof in the book مبسوط.
على المخالف في مسألة اعتاق الرقبة ثم ذكر حديث معاوية بن الحكم السلمي.
And then he goes on to mention showing that Allah is above his arsh, above the heavens. He goes on to mention the hadith of معاوية الحكمي رحمه رضي الله تعالى عنه.
وكيف أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سأل الجارية أين الله فقالت في السماء.
And he goes on to mention in the hadith how the Messenger of Allah asked the slave girl, where is Allah? And then the slave girl said, Allah is above the heavens. And he goes on to ask her, who am I? And she said, you are the Messenger of Allah. So the Messenger of Allah turned to Muawiyah and he said, free her, for verily she's a true believer. So the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, in this hadith affirm that she believed in Allah by establishing that Allah, or she established that Allah Ta'ala was above the heavens. So we understand from this that the one who does not establish, does not believe that Allah is above the heavens, that this one is not a true believer.
والحديث في صحيح مسلم.
And this hadith is collected by Imam Muslim.
والشاهد من هذا أنه يثبت بإثبات العلو والاستواء على ما يليق بجلال الله تعالى وعظمته الإيمان.
So we understand from this, Ikhwan, and the point here is that the person has to believe that Allah, in a manner that fits His majesty, in a manner that befits Allah, that He has the quality or the characteristic of Al-Ulu, that He is above, and that Allah is not among His creation, that this is from Iman. Translators note, Ya Ikhwan, this is extremely important because we live in Atlantic City and we have some Muslims in Atlantic City who believe that you cannot say that Allah is above the heavens. So this is extremely, extremely important to know that this belief is in reality incorrect. For the person to say Allah is everywhere, that this is not correct. That in reality, this is not the belief of Ahl Sunnah. So this point here, I pray and I hope that the brothers and sisters pay close attention to this regard, that in reality it's imperative upon the person to understand and to believe that Allah is just as He describes Himself, and Allah is just as His Prophet Muhammad has described Him, alayhi salatu salam, that He is in fact above His creation, above the heavens. As the last hadith that was mentioned by the Shaykh Abdullah, hafidhahullah ta'ala, that's collected by Imam Muslim.
وينفى الإيمان عمن نفى.
And the one who does not believe this, his iman is negated. The one who does not believe that Allah is above the heavens, assalamu alaikum, that this one is not a true believer.
وروى عن عبد الله بن أبي جعفر الرازي أنه ضرب قرابة له بالنعل.
And it was been mentioned from Abdullah Ibn Razi that, or Abu Ja'far al-Razi, that he struck a man with his sandals.
عَلَى رَأْسِهِ إِذْ كَانَ يَرَى رَأْيَ جَهْمْ.
He struck him with his sandals upon his head, the one who had the belief of the Jahmiyyah, meaning the one who used to say Allah's everywhere. So when he heard someone say that, he used to strike them with his sandals upon their face.
وهو يقول لا يعني لا أدعك حتى تقول الرحمن على العرش استوى.
And upon seeing this individual who had this belief, and he would strike him upon his head with his sandal, he would say, I'm not letting you go until you believe that Allah is just as He says about Himself, that the most merciful is above His heavens.
بائن من خلقه.
And He is not among the creation.
ذكره ابن أبي حاتم في رده على الجهمية ونقله ابن القيم في الاجتماع وغير واحد.
And this was mentioned by Ibn Abd al-Hatim in his refutation against the Jahmiyyah and their belief and their ideology. And likewise it was mentioned by Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala.
وعن حماد بن هناد البوشنجي.
Likewise حماد بن حماد الحنجنجي rahimahullah ta'ala, it was mentioned by him.
ذكر في عقيدة الله قال هذا ما رأينا عليه أهل الأنصار.
And he said, this is what I seen the people from Al-Ansar upon.
وما دلت عليه مذاهبهم.
And that which their madhab, the proofs of their madhab points to.
وإيضاح منهاج العلماء وطرق الفقهاء.
And the scholars of Al-Hadith and likewise the scholars of Al-Fiqh, the jurists.
وصفة السنة وأهلها.
And likewise, the people who attribute themselves to the Sunnah of the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, that Allah is in fact above His seven heavens, above His arsh. And He is not among His creation. He is not among His creation. But His knowledge is in every place, in his sultan, in his qudra, in his might and authority is in every place.
وهذه إشارة منه رحمه الله تعالى إلى أن علماء الأمصار ليس فقط في زمن الرازيين بل بعد ذلك كثير إلى زمن البوشنجي رحمه الله تعالى.
And he says this is a clear proof that the scholars of Al-Ansar, they are not only up to the time of these two great imams, but they have also passed that time, and they keep on going on into the time of Al-Binhanji rahimahullah ta'ala.
وهم على هذه العقيدة.
And they are among unisons upon the belief system of Ahl Sunnah.
عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة.
The belief of Ahl Sunnah والجماعة.
من أن الله جل وعلا مستوى على عرشه استواء يليق بجلاله وعظمته.
That Allah is in fact Himself Ta'ala above the seven heavens, above His arsh, in a manner that suits His Majesty. Translators note, this is likewise extremely important. How are the qualities and attributes of Allah? The correct opinion, you don't try to explain, you don't try to bring the tafsir, you don't try to bring examples, you say that Allah is just as He described Himself, that Allah is just as the Messenger of Allah has described Him, and we acknowledge this, and we believe in this, that Allah is above in a manner that befits His Majesty. Allah hears everything in a manner that fits His Majesty. How does Allah see everything in a manner that fits His Majesty? How is the might of Allah in the manner that fits His Majesty in His tremendousness, His greatness, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do not try to explain, you do not deny, you do not bring similitudes and examples. This is the true methodology of Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah. And that Allah is above the Arsh and He is not among His creation. And that He is not among His creation.
بلا كيف يعني بلا كيف معلوم.
He says, and then they go on to mention, we believe in this without saying how. The Sheikh says, meaning the how that is known.
إلا فالكيف موجود. فالكيف موجود. ولهذا روي عن الإمام مالك رحمه الله وشيخه ربيعة.
And he said, for this reason, it was mentioned by Imam Malik and one of his teachers, Rabi'a. You sisters write down this name. Likewise, your brothers. Imam Malik, his name is Abu Abdullah Malik ibn Anas. Abu Abdullah Malik ibn Anas. One of his teachers, his name was Rabi'a. Rabi'a. That was one of the mashaykh of Imam Malik. Rabi'a. So Imam Malik said this statement, likewise his teacher used to say this statement. And the meaning of it was also mentioned from other scholars that came later on. When he was asked about how is Allah above, one of the people came to Imam Malik and asked him, Al-Istiwa, كيف الاستiwa? He asked him, Ya Imam, how is Allah above? How? Explain this.
أنه قال الاستواء معلوم.
So this Imam said, وعليكم السلام, الاستواء معلوم. He said, how Allah is above is known. Is known.
والكيف مجهول.
And the كيف is unknown. And the كيف is unknown. Translators note, there are some things that Allah has taught the human. And there's some things that how it is, Allah has left alone. Allah has left not teaching the individual. So some things you're going to know. Allah has taught the individual. And some things Allah has left unknown. An example of that, something that many of our brothers in Africa, some of our brothers from the Arab lands, some of our brothers from America, we get caught up in. And we try to argue what was the color of Adam. Our prophet, Adam alayhi salam. You have the African brother, he's arguing Adam was Africa or African. And then you have the Arab brother, Adam was Arab. And then you have the Egyptian brother, Adam was Misriyan. And then you have this one arguing. What was his nationality? What was his color? Where was he? This is known that Allah, when he descended from the heavens, Adam was on the earth. But where was he? Hadha majhul. This likewise was unknown. Likewise, there are seven earths. In the authentic hadith, the Messenger of Allah, رَبُّ السَّمَوَاتِ السَّبْعِ وَالْأَرَضِينَ السَّبْعِ, he used to say, the Lord of the seven heavens and the Lord of the seven earths. Today, no scientist has come and said, oh, I see these seven earths that the Prophet was saying. But it's known, but it's unknown. It's mentioned, it's ma'lum, but the how, the where, is unknown. And this is like that many times, ikhwan. Some things are known in Islam, but there's some intricate details that Allah from His mercy has left unknown. Likewise, as one brother asked me today about, what's the rule of celebrating the birth of the Prophet, alayhi salatu salam? The Prophet was born, alayhi salam. He's not an angel, alayhi salam. But in reality, when he was born, the exact day, the scholars differ. No one can give you in unison with no ikhtilaf the day, the exact day the Prophet was born. Another issue that comes to my mind, as the brother asked me earlier, okay, what's the ruling on celebrating the birth of the Prophet? I challenge any Muslim, black or white, Arab or non-Arab, male or female, big or small, what else, Ikhwan? To come and bring one authentic hadith, not 10, not 20, not 5, not 3. Bring one authentic. Okay, forget authentic. Bring one weak. Forget weak. Bring one fabricated hadith that the Prophet of Allah used to celebrate his birthday. Okay, put the Prophet of Allah to the side. Bring one companion, not 10, not 5, not 3 of the wives, not 2 of the wives. Bring me one of the wives. Forget the wives for a moment. Bring one of the companions of the Messenger, alayhi salatu salam, that they used to celebrate the birth of the Prophet, alayhi salatu salam. Just one. Forget the companions of the Messenger of Allah for a moment. Bring one tabi'i. Not 10, not 5, not 3, not 2. Just bring one that he used to celebrate the birth of the Prophet, alayhi salatu salam. Forget the companions of tabi'un, that's about tabi'in. Bring one of the righteous from the scholars of Al-Islam that he used to celebrate the birth of the Prophet. Forget the righteous for a moment. Bring one prophet of Allah, not the Prophet Muhammad, the last prophet. Bring any of the prophets of Allah. Musa, Harun, Isa, Yaqub, Ibrahim, Noah, Musa. Bring any prophet Jewish that he used to celebrate his own birthday. Bring one of the companions of any prophet you choose. You choose the prophet. I won't choose for you. You choose the prophet. Bring his companions, one of them, that they used to celebrate the birth of the prophet, their prophet. Even the Christians tell you, this is not from religion. The Christians say, we celebrate birthday or Isa, Christmas. We believe that Christmas, A'udhu Billah, is the birth of, they say, our God. A'udhu Billah. Doesn't even make sense to an animal. And you have Muslims arguing. Oh, calling the masjid. So every Christmas, the same. It's like the same people. Over and over and over. Every Christmas. Yahi, I'm not going to go to my mom's birth, my mom's Christmas. I'm not going to eat the food that she directly made for Christmas. MashaAllah. It's the same issue. Same issue. You saying back to the man at the Walmart when he says to you, Merry Christmas, brother. You say, thank you, and the same for you. You're praising his holiday. But rather you should say, I'm Muslim. I don't celebrate Christmas. Or I don't believe, you really want to get da'wah, I don't believe that to be correct. So I don't celebrate it. If you really want to give da'wah, it's not from my religion, nor is it from yours. For example, sometimes we have to stand up. I don't mean fight everybody and beat everybody down. Honorably, Islamically. Like the man who likes the Muslim girl, the disbeliever. Like one brother said, it's so, one non-Muslim said, it's easy to get the Muslim women's phone numbers. When I was a billah, talking about a non-Muslim. He said it's easy for the non-Muslim men nowadays to get the Muslimah phone number, her contact, her whatever. But it shouldn't be like that. If she stands up, no matter how handsome he may be, no matter what he's driving, how many motorcycles he has, as that's what's important to our women nowadays. Oh, girl, he drives a such and such. He has two bikes. MashaAllah. She should stand up like Sulaim, the mother of Anas ibn Malik, when Abu Talha wanted to marry her. And she said, مِثْلُكَ يَا أَبَا طَلْحَ لَا يُرَدْ وَلَكِنَّنِي مُسْلِمًا. And she said a tremendous statement that I hope our Muslim women understand. She smashed him out Islamically, honorably, in a noble way. She said, the likes of you, Ya Abu Talha, are never going to be rejected. The likes of you, he was handsome. The likes of you, he was wealthy. The likes of you, he was of great stature in the community. What else do you need? Money. He's handsome and he's noble among the people. She said, however, I am a Muslima and it's not allowed for me to marry you. Now, he thought about it. He said, okay, let me see what Muhammad and his companions is talking about. Worship Allah. Make some salah. Give a little bit of my money. Be honorable. Be obedient. Treat my wife in a noble way. Fast a few days out the year. Visit the Kaaba. Okay, doesn't seem too bad. And he came back and he said, Shahadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Sulaim said, Anas, qum wa zawwij ummaka. She said, Anas, her son, get up and marry your mother off. Now it's allowed for her to marry the man because he's a Muslim. And a person can say it appears that he accepted Islam for the woman. It does appear that way. But he goes on in his actions to show that he was a true Muslim. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. At any rate, I say this to say, Ikhwan, that many of the non-Muslimin, they look at the Muslim women and she wears a jilbab. And they look nice, mashallah. Some of the women, they look like princesses. Alhamdulillah, noble. A jilbab, a khimar. Some of the women wear the niqab. Some of the women wear the gloves. That's nice. So the non-Muslim man is going to be attracted. So he may try to come with his AC slang or his Philly speech. At any rate, you stand up and you say, I'm a Muslima. Shukran for your flattery or whatever, but I'm not allowed in my religion. And I'm not ashamed to say, to marry the likes of a non-Muslim. Now, if he really likes you, he's going to go back. Let me see this Bukhari. Let me see this Quran. And then you never know. Maybe he accepts Islam. And then you can marry that man if you wish. That's allowed, ya Ikhwan. Some people say it's not recommended to marry a new Shahada. But there's no proof to that. Walhamdulillah. If she truly accepts Islam, or he truly accepts Islam, usually the new Shahada has a thirst, has a hunger to learn, to memorize, more so than the Muslim who's been Muslim 5 or 6 or 7 years. At any rate, some brothers teach in their lessons, it's not recommended to marry a new Shahada. Some brothers teach, it's not recommended to get married to someone you just met. I say to them, go back to the history of the companions of the Messenger of Allah. Sometimes the whole sit-down process that we have nowadays, I don't know where we got that from. Where you sit with the girl and y'all have sit-downs for a year or sit-downs for 6 months or 2 years. That's more like you guys are dating. That's not a sit-down. Even the whole word sit-down, where did we get that from? It'd be more of an interview or a muqabala, if you want to say. To translate that to be a sit-down would be a terrible translation. At any rate, more of an interview process where you're asking her some questions, she's asking you some questions, and usually they would get married right after that. Also, the look, like many of us, some of the women, some of the brothers, he knows he doesn't want to get married, but he sees the girl, oh, she's a little shorty, she's this, she's that, she's tall, she's short, she's dark-skinned, she's light-skinned. He knows he's not interested in marrying her, but he just wants to sit with her. I want to see her and see what she looks like. So they sit down. In reality, I tell the women the same thing I tell my own daughter. For example, if someone wants to marry you, you don't just flip up your niqab like that. La. The look is the last thing. You look at him and he looks at you. If everything is in order, you did your investigation, you checked out his family, you checked out his work, you checked out his aqidah, you checked his behavior, you checked his knowledge, you checked his methodology, and he did the same for you, and you guys are pleased with what you reached so far, or what reached you so far, so now you look at him and he looks at you. That should be the last thing. Because sometimes, for those women who cover, What's the benefit of you covering if everyone in the community has seen you? What's the benefit? So you let the one who shows you that, if I'm pleasing to you, brother, after this, we're going to get married. Right? You agree to that? Yes. Okay, now you can look at me. Because some of the people nowadays, and it's, I don't know, Abu Yehwan, you have the right to choose what you're attracted to, at any rate. But sometimes we have to ask ourselves, not what are we attracted to, but what's pleasing to our Lord. Sometimes the I hate to say it, I hope none of the women get offended. Some of our more thicker women, for example, usually they're overlooked because she's a little heavier on the heavier side. She's a little more chunky, at any rate. But usually, and this is not a knock to the J-Lo sisters, like I call them, the little mashallah sisters who her bag has to match her shoe, and her shoe has to match her gloss, and her gloss has to match her khimar, and her khimar has to match her shayla, and her shayla has to match her sock that no one's going to see, and then that belt that no one's going to see also has to match the strap of the bag, has to match the steering wheel column of the truck, and then all that nonsense, ya Juan, we call those sisters the J-Lo sisters, where everything has to match. And nowadays, then they hang with the ones who match them also in their color. Sometimes at the Jumu'ah. And you see how we, you know, how we do it in our masjid. When Audhu Billah, we have the post up. You know, the brothers, we have a post up position. And the sisters have a post up position. And wallah, every Jumu'ah is the same. The brothers run out here. Not the ones going to work. Not the ones going to school. But the ones running to post up. They go post up. Their little spot, the men, we have our little spot as the men. And then the women, they run out of here also, not to go to work, not to go to school, but to post up also. So now you have a crowd of brothers posting up, and a crowd of the women posting up. And your Ikhwan, it's not honorable. At any rate, now you have some of the women, they even hang with the women who matches them. You know, this one, her khimar matches her jilbab, and her jilbab matches her shoe. It's funny, Ikhwan, at any rate. This is just something, Ikhwan, not talking about no one who just happens to be there, those spots, but sometimes we post up just to look at the women who come out, and then some of the women come out just to stand there to look at the men who come out. It's okay to want to get married, Ikhwan. Some of our brothers are handsome. Some of our women are cute, alhamdulillah, but it's better to cover. Some of the women have a problem with the jilbab and with the khimar because it covers their beauty. This is from Islam. The Muslim woman is not the woman who beautifies herself to go out. She should cover her beauty. This is the benefit of a jilbab. It covers your aura. It covers your body. Likewise, the niqab and the screen and the likes. Yes, you want to look presentable, but you're not looking all dazzled and mashallah to go out. If you do that, then this is tabarruj and this is a sin in Islam. And the Messenger of Allah mentioned about the one who wears the fragrance, that anyone she passes by, that innahu zani wa hiya zaniya, anyone she passes by that smells her fragrance, she is someone who falls into fornication, and likewise the man similarly. But the woman should cover her beauty. And then, more amazing than that, some of our women folk, they are beautiful when they go out, but then in the house, the man, the husband, all he gets to see is pajamas after pajamas after pajamas after pajamas. Okay, when are you going to get dressed up? When are you going to look nice? When are you going to do something nice with your hair? Some braids or something? I can do braids, mashallah. Some braids, a little comb back. The women, they get dressed up to go out. Sister Aqeeqah, Sister Walima. That's fine. To go to the masjid, alhamdulillah. But what about in the home? It's as if they forgot that is you can get a reward. You mean to tell me as a wife, just to look nice, I'll get a reward? Yes. Just from looking presentable. Your husband is out all day long with women he can't look at. And then the one that he can look at still has on her pajamas from earlier. Alhamdulillah. If you just did something nice, no hadith, no ayah, you just look presentable, you get a reward. That's tremendous. And many times we forget that, ya ikhwan. So now we return back to the words of the Shaykh. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.
والكيف مجهول.
So Imam Malik goes on to say to the man, or Imam Malik goes on to say rather, after being asked, the istiwa is known, But the كيف, the how Allah is above is unknown.
فالكيف موجود لكنه مجهول.
So he said كيف is there, it is there, but it's unknown how Allah is in this aspect.
لأنه من علم الغيب.
Because this is from the knowledge of the unseen. This is from the knowledge of the علم الغيب, of the unseen.
وعلم الغيب استأثر الله عز وجل به.
And the knowledge of the unseen is only with Allah. It's only with Allah.
عالم الغيب فلا يظهر على غيبه أحدا.
And then we started the ayah that comes somewhere in Juz Tabarak, Surah Al-Din, I believe, that comes to my mind at this moment. As Allah Ta'ala says, and He is عالم الغيب. He is the knower, the all-knower of the unseen. And no one knows the unseen except those that Allah has informed of.
والله عز وجل قال جل وعلا وما يعلم تأويله إلا الله.
And Allah Ta'ala goes on to say, and no one knows the ta'wil of Allah except Allah.
على الوقف في القراءة السبعية على لفظ الجلالة أي وما يعرف تفسيره إلا الله.
Meaning, as the scholars mentioned, no one knows the tafsir of Allah, the explanation of Allah except Allah.
قالوا هذا في معرفة حقائق الأشياء وكيفياتها مما هو من الغيب.
And the scholars, they mentioned this is from those affairs, the reality of those affairs, from the knowledge of the unseen, those affairs that only Allah knows Himself.
الذي لا يعلم إلا الله.
Those affairs that only Allah has knowledge of.
وعلى القراءة الأخرى وما يعلم تأويله إلا الله والراسخون في العلم وهي قراءة سبعية أخرى.
And he said there's another way to recite the ayah. He's talking about the verse in Surah Al-Imran. If you don't stop there, لا يعلم تأويله إلا الله. But you instead of pausing there, you continue والراسخون and those who are grounded in knowledge.
يكون العلم الذي يعلمه خاصة أهل العلم والراسخون فيه من تفسير ما هو في إمكانهم. وأما الأول فما سبق فقولهما بلا كيف أي بلا كيف معلوم.
So when those two great Imams of Al-Razi go on to say, so we believe in this without saying how, he says the how here, the how is there, but it's unknown.
وأما الكيف فهو موجود ولكنه من الغيب الذي لا يعلمه إلا الله.
So the كيف is there, but the كيف, the how, is from those affairs that are unknown, they're from the غيب, and only Allah has knowledge of how Allah is in this regard. A translator's note, a benefit. It's like this in all of the attributes and qualities of Allah. Not just that Allah is above. Whenever you're defining or you're bringing the qualities or attributes, the sifat of Allah, we believe in them without the how. Meaning that the how is there, but it's unknown. A man may say, like one brother used to say, in America it's dark, it's nighttime, and overseas it's light. So you brothers believe Allah comes down in the lowest night of the lowest heavens at the last part of the night from the hadith of Abu Hurairah. So now they say, okay, this hadith is weak. You say, okay, firstly, anyone who says something is weak in our religion, who preceded you in saying it's weak? What's the weakness of it? It's not that you just say it's weak. La, who are you? So now, why is it weak? A man may say, okay, because your mind doesn't rationalize that. In America, it's nighttime. Overseas, it's dark time. The globe or the world is as like a globe. So it's not dark altogether, it's not light altogether. On one half of the hemisphere is dark, while on the other half of the hemisphere is light. So how can Allah be down and up at the same time? Now to your mind, that's a strong argument, to your mind. Ahl al-Sunnah says what? We believe Allah is just as He says about Himself, and just as His Prophet says about Himself, or just as all the Prophets say about Him, alayhi salatu salam. We acknowledge this without saying how, meaning that how was unknown. So how is Allah above the seven heavens? In a manner that fits His Majesty. You brothers learn that phrase. مَا يَلِيقُ بِجَلَالَتِهِ. He, in a manner that fits His Majesty. You don't try to explain. One of the brothers one time did a Jumu'ah and he said, Allah comes down to the lowest heavens just like now I'm on the minbar, and then he stepped down. Just like that. That's an action of disbelief. That's an action of disbelief. One of the brothers said, Allah sits on the arsh just like I'm sitting upon the chair. A'udhu billah. That's a statement or action of disbelief. You believe in these affairs in a manner, how are they? In a manner that fits His Majesty. How does Allah see all things? In a manner that fits His Majesty. How does Allah hear all things? In a manner that fits His Majesty. You memorize this, teach your husbands, teach your wives, teach your children. What's the benefit of a lesson? Why your husband is ignorant. What's the benefit of coming to class? Why your wife is ignorant. What's the benefit of a class? Why your children are ignorant. Go home and teach. You brothers that have wives, you women that have husbands, especially your children, especially your daughters, teach your family. Everything you learn, you brothers that take notes, before you lay down, teach your wives. You brothers that teach, before you come to class, if your wife doesn't come to class, teach her what you're going to teach the people. She has more right over you than the people. Unless you're teaching a room of your wives, then they're equal. At any rate, nowadays it's hard. Wallahi, ikhwan. Many of us who come, most of us are married. And this is not a knock to none of us. Or it'll be a knock to myself likewise. Most of us are married. But we don't come to the masjid as a family. Most of us. I'm not talking about Jumu'ah. Even Jumu'ah we don't come as a family. Most of us. But then you see some families, alhamdulillah, who come outside of Jumu'ah. Most of us, we come, the man comes, the wife is somewhere else. Or the wives come, and the man is somewhere else. Many of us have children. We don't come with our children. Many of the brothers have children. We don't come with our children. Many of the wives have children. They don't come with their children. It's usually one person in the family. This is good and bad. Because what about the da'wah? Allah Ta'ala says, "Wal asri innal insana lafi khusr illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihat wa tawassaw bil haqq wa tawassaw bis sabr." Allah Ta'ala says, verily by the time mankind is in a state of loss, all of them, except those who believe and does actions of righteousness, and those who exhort one another to the truth, da'wah, and those who are patient. When you're trying to call someone and teach the people good, there's always going to be people against you. That's a sunnah from the sunnah of the creation of Allah. If you try to teach the people or invite the people to Allah, and no one was in opposition of you, now you have to check yourself. It's always going to be someone. Nowadays it's two people, or three people, or four people. At any rate, keep on doing what you're doing. If you're doing it for Allah's sake. Look at Surah Al-Asr. وَتَوَاسُوا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاسُوا بِالصَّبْرِ. And those who exhort one another to the truth, and they are patient. Those who exhort one another to patience. At any rate, we have to call. The first calls to ourselves. Then those who are closest to you. Who's closer to a wife than a husband? Who's closer to a husband than his wife? Then the children. That's how we branch out. Then the people. Many of us, we call the people, what about your husband? Many of the sisters, they get online, they can send ayat, send hadith, Twitter, mashallah, Facebook, mashallah, posts, texts. Okay, most of the people who send these ayat or hadith, you want to ask them, did you read what you just sent, ya akhi? This is you. You talking about you, bismillah, first. This is you, akh. No disrespect, but did you read it? Oh, I didn't read it. I knew you didn't read it, bismillah. That's you. The da'wah is first us, then you branch out. That's the sunnah of the Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Now you have your family on board, your wives on board, your husbands on board, your children on board, and now you branch out. And that's what a community is. This brother and his wife, that brother and his wife, that those two children, that family down the road, now we all come together. Many of us in this masjid, we're only brothers in the masjid. When we leave, look at how we give salams to each other. Some of the brothers come and give salams. Nobody gives us salams back. That's not my man. He's not in my circle. I don't mess with homeboy. Look how we refer to one another. Oh, I'm not with those dudes. A'udhu billah. Who are you talking about? Those brothers, Muslims. How you call them those dudes? Those knuckleheads. A'udhu billah. You pray with them. You break fast with them. And now they're knuckleheads. Now they're those dudes. When did the Prophet refer to his companions like that? When the Prophet Hadith Jabir, And he said, Da'uha. And he said, leave that off. For indeed it's a da'wah jahiliyah. It's a call of the pre-Islamic times of ignorance. You call it, those dudes over there. A'udhu billah. Because you don't pray that masjid. They're still Muslims. Inshallah, they're still Muslims. So you shouldn't refer to them as those dudes. I'm not with those knuckleheads. I'm not with... A'udhu billah. But that's how it is to many of us. What about the sunnah of our Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam? So we'll finish, inshallah, ya and we'll take a few more minutes of the Shaykh, and then we'll stop and pray Isha, and then we'll have our class after that, inshallah, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. All of this, ikhwan, is just advice, firstly, for myself, and then for my brothers and my sisters, as indeed we intend good for one another, but sometimes it's like, we give salams, barely, nowadays, and we forget that we're brothers, inshallah, to one another. When was the last time we called each other? Just want to check on you. I don't want nothing from you. I just want to give you salams. Sometimes you see certain people's name on the phone, you'll be like, oh man, that's such and such. He must need a ride. Or he must need me to do something. Sometimes it's like that. But it shouldn't be like that. I just want to give you salams. I was in Walmart. You know, I know you was going, you know you're going to say no, but do you need anything? Ask your wife, is something that you'll need while mama out here? Alhamdulillah. Nowadays, the sisters, let another sister come to her house and she's married. She's going to get offended. Oh, when you come, my husband is here. When you come here? She may think, oh, she must like you. It's not always about that. Maybe she just wanted to give you salams. The brother's driving in his car one time. You see a Muslim sister with bags, struggling. He said, oh, let's get a sister rock. First thing the wife's going to say. What's she going to say, Shakir?
Like
oh, you interested in her? Let me call the masjid. She call it. He must like that sister. Like, yeah, he. I just, the sister has 7 bags. You gonna keep past, we got a minivan. I'm in love. You can take the car. I can sit back, come back and pick me up. It's not always about that. Yeah, you now you want a second wife now? Oh, let me go. It's not always. Marriage is good, ikhwan. It's like we forget. Marriage is good. Man, mashallah. May Allah help us. Yeah. If the women nowadays, they want to leave you anyway, because you want to take on a second wife or third or fourth, she wanted to leave you. If she's going to say, you know what, if you marry such and such, or if you want to get married, just let me go in kindness. Okay, that's not from Islam, but we might as well part now. Because if you, that's your reason, most likely you want to bingo. You already checked out. You just ain't return the key. You already left. You just still the key is still right there. And that's how many of us are. Wallahi. Is it always about that? The woman goes to visit her sister in Islam. Oh, my husband is here, sister. No, I don't. Alhamdulillah. Did the salaf do that? The wives used to serve. Let her brother go to another brother's house. When his wife is there, he won't even open the door. Like, whoa, assalamu alaikum. Hey, wife, salam. Whoa, my wife's still here, huh? She ain't go to work yet. Alhamdulillah, okay. I can't come visit you. She about to leave, inshallah. She do the second shift today. Come back, inshallah, in 3 hours. Alhamdulillah. Is it always about that? What about the brotherhood? In the time of the companions, the wives used to serve the food. I challenge any woman now to dare try to serve the food around the guests of her husband. She's going to be divorced. I just want to serve the food to you and the companion. Oh, what you trying to get me out of the way? Because it's not always like that, ya ikhwan. We can be brothers and sisters to one another.
Gave him my piece of chicken.
Yeah, but it's like we forget, ya ikhwan, that this, in the time of the companions of the Messenger of Allah, the man that had 3 wives. And we'll stop here, inshallah. His brother had no wives. What would he do, Shaykh Khaled? Yeah. He would divorce one of his wives. Allahu Akbar. Mm-hmm. Y'all want to say Salafi, Sunnah. Okay, here's a Sunnah. Mm-hmm. I challenge any one of you to do this. The man would say, I got 3 wives, brother. I don't need all those girls. I got 3 of them. You. Y'all make me laugh, Shaykh Khaled. He would say, I got 3 of them. The man would do something even more honorable. He wouldn't just say, I'm going to divorce the raggediest one, the one I don't really care for, and then you can marry her. He didn't do that.
The one you like.
He would say, you look at him. You're my brother. Allahu Akbar. And you want to say, Salafi, Sunnah. Where are we from the likes of these men? Wallahi, ikhwan. Radiallahu anhum, radu'an. This is why Allah Ta'ala said, and Allah is pleased with them. and they are pleased with Allah. Where are we? The man would say, I got three of them. You look at the one that you like. I'll let her go in kindness, and you can marry her. Because you're my brother. And the wives wouldn't say a word. Now you try that now. You got three wives. I'm going to let the brother come in. He won't have no wives. Like, salah. I'm going to let the brother come in. And now he going to look at you. Whatever one he likes. Whoa, 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 whoa. I didn't sign up for this. Let me go right now. That's our women nowadays. Wallahi, ikhwan. Yeah. But it's the brotherhood that they had. A sister in the time would say, you can marry my husband. Nowadays, where is that from the time? Where are we from then, yo? Where are we? We can't even share food.
They want to see the sister in the mission.
Yeah. Ma'udhubillah. How many, that's a good point. How many of the Muslims come in the mission? One brother came, my own self. He said, you know, can you find somewhere I can stay, you know? As far as I know, no one helped them. They stayed in the mission. And he said, it's hard to stay there because the Christians, you know, you got to abide to some of their rules. You know, you got to go to their prayers.
Yep.
You got to go to their meetings. You got to go to their this and that. If you're going to, you want to stay there, you know, I haven't seen their brother since. And we pray he's okay. And may Allah Ta'ala make it easy on the Muslims, ikhwan. But we forget that brotherhood is from the sunnah of our Prophet, alayhi salatu salam. So we'll stop there, ikhwan. فَنَسَبْتُ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ وَنَأَخْطَأْتُ فَمِنْ نَفْسِي. Anything that I said that's correct is from Allah. Or anything I said that's incorrect is from myself. وَجَزَاكُمُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا. السلام عليكم.